Welcome to a special edition of Frank Buckley Interviews. This time on the program, we're talking about the COVID-19 coronavirus outbreak. Our guests, one man who survived coronavirus, Carl Goldman of Santa Clarita, whose dream vacation with his wife, Jerry, aboard a Princess Cruises ship, ended in a quarantine that would last more than 40 days.
I'm not allowed to leave my door. I'm get fed three meals a day. People still walk in, not in hazmat suits, but they come in full gear, fully protected gear. I get tests every day as well.
And we also have on the program Professor Anne Rimoin of UCLA's Fielding School of Public Health. She's the director of the Center for Global and Immigrant Health and one of the world's leading experts on emerging infectious diseases. And we are very pleased to welcome with us right off the bat here, Carl Goldman, who joins us via Skype from Santa Clarita. Carl, it is great to have you back here in Southern California after a very long dream vacation that ended in anything but a dream for you. Welcome back to Southern California.
Thanks, Frank. I am thrilled to be here.
Yeah. Tell me, for folks who are not completely familiar with your story, you were on a Princess Cruises cruise off in the waters of Asia. And what happened?
So, yes, I bought a cruise for my wife. Two of our friends also went with us, and we traveled throughout Southeast Asia, had 15 wonderful days of a 16-day cruise. On the final day, the captain announced that a passenger had gotten off in Hong Kong and had come down with the virus. Now, this is back in still mid-January, so number one, there were very few outbreaks anywhere other than in China. And number two, there was very little information about the virus because China was still suppressing that. The captain announced he was going to double his speed to Yokohama. Japanese health officials got on board. They then told us the next morning that we were going to be quarantined on board the ship for a total of 14 days. Looking back now, that ship was a walking Petri dish. And there ended up being 705 passengers, including me, who came down with the virus. And then, unfortunately, seven deaths as well, Frank.
Yeah. How did you know that you had it? Did you exhibit symptoms? Because as I recall, you got on an airplane and flew back to America, and then you were segregated into a different group that you were then taken to Nebraska.
Exactly. So I didn't show any symptoms of the coronavirus while on board the Diamond Princess. The day after Valentine's Day, our close friend, Jerry Jorgensen, who had been tested a little earlier, had come down with the virus. So my wife and I ended up doing tests as well on February 15th. We left the ship on February 17th, still with no symptoms. Those tests never arrived in time to let me know I had the virus. So when I boarded the plane, I still thought I was perfectly healthy. And later, 5 days later, the test caught up with me and showed that I was positive. On the plane, about 2 hours into the flight, I woke up with a very high fever, over 103. They put me in a special quarantined area on the plane, and I stayed there sleeping for the next 8 hours. Frank, what's unusual about the virus, but seems to be the common denominator for everyone, is unlike the common cold, there's no sore throat, no body aches, no headache, no sneezing, no sniffles. All that seems to be the one factor is that high fever for most people coming for a short period of time. In my case, it lasted the 8 hours of the flight and then disappeared. I was left with a very dry cough that remained for many weeks, and also a little bit of trouble breathing when I would be moving around. If I exercised, I would be breathing very, very, having challenges there. That lasted about 4, 5, 6 days, but then disappeared.
When you were in quarantine, people wonder, what is it like? We you know, many of us are now sort of in some level of self-quarantine or social distancing, but you were in an official quarantine. Can you tell me what life was like in quarantine?
Sure. My wife, who also was quarantined that whole time on the Diamond Princess, and then in Omaha, she was separated from me, quarantined differently. I was quarantined in a biocontainment center, and I'll talk about that in a second. But my wife came back to Santa Clarita a little over 2 weeks ago. She's now looking at her quarantine as a gift. I haven't been back here yet 24 hours, so I don't quite see it that way yet. But I think I will see that with a little distance on my quarantine because of all the things I now appreciate that I didn't at the time of the quarantine. In the biocontainment unit, it was like a scene out of the Andromeda strain or Contagion. I was put inside this room that was totally sealed off. No one entered the room unless they were wearing complete hazmat suits, kind of like Neil Armstrong when he landed on the moon. Mm-hmm. They even had a motor on the back of them to provide ventilation and air for the people in the suits, for my doctors and nurses. I was hooked up to monitors. There were two cameras aimed at me at all times going back to a central command post down the hall. And I could communicate back and forth virtually through those cameras to the staff that was there. A nurse, the first day, a doctor was in with me for 2 or 3 hours. Two nurses stayed in the entire day. And then the remaining days that I was there, once they realized I was stable, they then brought in nurses in suits every 4 hours to check on me, bring me my food. Yeah. My doctor would also come in a hazmat suit at least once a day and check up on me. So I was well cared for. The one thing I'm happy about is if I could have been anywhere in the world, it was Omaha, Nebraska, and that biocontainment unit.
Yeah.
They set that up, Frank, right after the anthrax scare after 9/11 and never used it for anthrax. 15 years later, they used it for Ebola. And then I was patient number 2 in there. I ended up staying in there for 10 days before I was downgraded over to a lesser unit of care where my wife was in the same building, although I wasn't allowed to be quarantined with my wife because she didn't have the virus, never got it. So I was in a lower level of care for the remainder of my time until late yesterday afternoon.
In the weeks and months ahead, Carl, more and more people are going to contract the COVID-19 strain of coronavirus. Some of us are in fear of that happening. Is there anything you can say that would reassure folks that it's going to be okay? Obviously, not everyone is going to survive, sadly, but what can you say to reassure us as someone who has survived it?
Absolutely, Frank. And 80% of the people who are getting the virus are getting it in mild doses like I received it. It's the 20% that have the possibility of it getting into their respiratory system that have the challenges. And then most of those either have pre-existing conditions or they are very, very elderly. And then, of course, as you mentioned, the 3.4% who are dying, that's tragic. But for 80% of the people, it's like a mild cold. I would have been back to work 48 hours later. So just deal with the quarantine by trying to stay in the present. Look at it as making lemonade out of lemons. You're probably going to come up with some incredible intuition about yourself over time. And certainly once you get out, you'll be able to look back at it. I believe, as my wife is currently looking back, as a gift, and see it for all the positive possibilities that can come out of this.
And Carl, one more question. Are you going to go on another cruise?
Absolutely. Princess has been wonderful. First of all, they've been wonderful throughout all this. It's easy to put the blame on Princess and the Japanese health officials saying that they should never have kept us on board the ship. So it became a learning process. Unfortunately, there were some mistakes made with it, and they've learned from that with now the Grand Princess and other ships not to keep people on board the ship. But I would definitely take another cruise.
Carl, for folks who want to read your entire story, you've done a magnificent job of blogging about all of it. Where do they find that?
That's at hometownstation.com. I'm still blogging. So many people have asked me to continue now that I'm home, so I will be continuing to do this, hopefully to calm people down, let them see what this is like from the inside perspective, and just keep communicating out there and letting people know that it doesn't have to be as bad as it sounds.
All right, Carl Goldman, we appreciate you, and it's great to see you again.
Thank you, Frank. You take care.
All right, you too. All right, coming up next, we're going to be joined by Dr. Anne Rimoin, one of the world's leading experts on emerging infectious diseases. And welcome back. Joining us now is Dr. Anne Rimoin, one of the world's leading experts on infectious and emerging diseases. She's a professor of epidemiology in the UCLA Fielding School of Public Health and director of the Center for Global and Immigrant Health. Thank you so much for joining us and for helping us to understand what's happening to us right now in our society and here, of course, in Southern California. Why is it happening now?
I mean, diseases cross species all the time. You can't stop diseases from crossing species, and they happen probably on a daily basis. The issue is it's just chance. Sometimes things will jump from animal to animal. They'll hit a human. And from once it gets into a human population, things just kind of spiral from person to person to person. Yeah. You can never predict when it's going to happen. All you can do is be ready and work to be able to stop spread as quickly as possible. And unfortunately, the world was not ready to stop disease from spreading this quickly. We've been talking a lot about pandemics for a very long time. Yeah. There's been a lot of lip service to preventing pandemics before they start. And we're right now in a situation where we're living through what used to be a hypothetical.
Yeah. This COVID-19 strain of coronavirus, it's described as a novel virus. What does that mean? And how does this novel virus differ from past novel viruses that we've seen throughout history?
So a novel virus just means a new virus that has never been identified before. And this virus has never been identified in an animal or a human. This is completely new to science. Mm-hmm. Comparing this to other emerging diseases, we've seen many over the years. We've seen Ebola. The first time anybody noted Ebola was back in 1976. Nobody had ever seen it before. Nobody had ever heard of it before, and the world had to grapple with it. Luckily, in when Ebola emerged, it was in two very small villages in the Democratic Republic of Congo and Sudan, easily contained. Many, many fewer casualties, but that was one of the first big emerging infections that we noted. But we've had many others. We've had avian influenza, we've had swine flu, we've had SARS, we've had MERS. Mm. You know, a novel virus jumping into humans and spreading is not new to us, just the scale of it is new.
And the scale of this compared to some of those others that you listed, is it worse? And I don't know if that's the right way to describe it, but is it something that we haven't, as you said, we haven't been prepared for this, but is it worse compared to the others?
We have not seen a novel virus jumping into humans and spreading so quickly throughout the entire population before. And some of that is because this is just a new virus in and of itself, but also because the scale of human travel now has changed enormously. Mm. Many people have said, well, we've had other pandemics, including the 1918 pandemic flu. But back in 1918, people were not traveling at the scale that they're traveling now. So I think the confluence of a population explosion, people foraging further into rainforests and previously untouched territory with fauna and flora, the explosion of extractive industries and bushmeat industries, global warming, and travel has made it very easy for viruses to jump and to move into new populations quickly.
Dr. Anthony Fauci and others have said, look, this is going to get worse before it gets better. Do you agree?
Absolutely.
And what does that look like?
I think what it will actually look like is anybody's guess. However, that said, we can look to what's happening in Italy. We can look what's happened in South Korea. We can look what's happened in Singapore, in France, in Germany, in many other countries to see what could happen depending upon the containment and mitigation methods that we put into place. All of these things that we've been talking about, the social distancing, good hygiene, making sure that people are as far apart from each other as possible. All of these things make an enormous difference. I think the thing that people don't realize is that we have control over what happens with this virus, and it all has to do with the kind of control measures that we put into place and as a society that we work together to reinforce.
And to that point, this idea of social distancing and the fact that we're trying to stay 4 to 6 feet away from each other, we're not shaking hands, we're not doing some of the things that we used to do all the time pre-COVID-19. On social distancing, I saw this graphic in the Washington Post, and they were kind enough to share it with us, and I wanted to share it with our viewers because it gave me a sense of what social distancing can do and how quickly the virus spreads when we don't have social distancing. So the picture on your right, as you can see, it's labeled a free-for-all. And on the right side, it says extensive distancing. And we can see above that, as the graph that we've talked about, the line that we're trying to flatten. And you can see very clearly on the right with the social distancing, or the extensive distancing, that we never have that gigantic hill of people getting sick. Is that really what ultimately the social distancing is about?
Absolutely. The reason that we want to do social distancing is it keeps people from interacting with each other, which is how this virus is spread. This virus is spread from person-to-person contact or sick people touching surfaces that other people will come in contact with. So in any case, just people being close together, touching, sharing surfaces, or being in close contact is what spreads this virus. And so if we can reduce that by keeping people in place and avoiding a lot of social mixing, we will do what the other term we're hearing a lot about is flatten the curve. This epidemic curve that you see right now, which is currently on just an upswing. What we want it to do is we want to see it start to come down. Mm-hmm. And the way to be able to do that is to keep people away from each other and to keep people who are sick at home. If we can do that, we will see a difference in the number of cases. This is what will change the rate of spread and what this epidemic curve looks like.
But we shouldn't think, as I understand it, that we're not going to become infected. We are still going to have a relatively high rate of exposure, if not infection. But I guess the idea is with the social distancing, it's going to happen over time as opposed to all of us getting sick in the next 2 weeks.
Correct. And the reason that we need to do that is that we need to protect our medical system. Our hospitals are already overburdened. It's already flu season. The hospitals operate with maximum capacity normally just because that is standard practice. They have to keep open. It's their own economics of staying open. But to add an onslaught of patients on the scale that we're going to see with this kind of disease will absolutely take them over the edge. And that's what we're seeing in Italy. That's what we saw in Wuhan in China, is the places that the health systems have been overwhelmed, you see a much higher mortality rate. And because the hospital system is overwhelmed, people can't get ventilators, they can't get the care that they need, and therefore more people die. In Wuhan, they had the epicenter of this, Wuhan had a very high case fatality rate, whereas the rest of China that had a little bit more time to prepare had a much lower case fatality rate. So I think we need to look at what's happened in other places and really take heed. We can flatten this curve, we can save lives, and we can preserve our health system as long as we do social distancing.
All right, we're going to take a break. We're going to have one more final word with Dr. Rimoin and hear from a journalist in Italy about what the situation is there, with a warning for us here in the U.S.
I think people should understand that they can change the course of things and not repeat the mistake that we did in wasting time. And the message is, people need to act and social distance in a serious way before it's too late, before it looks like the situation looks very bad. But once it's already seemingly under control, it's not under control. We need to act now.
And that's the Italian journalist Mattia Faradesi from Il Foglio newspaper. Dr. Rimoin, as you were listening to that, just your thoughts.
I think he's right. You know, what you see today is not really where we are. This is, people are currently being infected. There are, you know, an average of 5 days, but up to 14 days of incubation period. So anybody that is getting infected right now with our current practices of not very serious social distancing will be actually infected anywhere from 5 to 14 days from now. So what we see today is just what happened 2 weeks ago, not what's happening 2 weeks from now.
And as we have more and more testing that happens in the U.S. and in California in particular, will our numbers spike?
Absolutely. We know that there are many, many more cases out there. The virus is here, it's everywhere in the country. And the problem has been is that we just haven't had the tests to be able to identify people accurately. And the tests need to be widespread, they need to be rapid and available to everybody that needs one. And that just hasn't been the case. We've been far behind that curve. So once testing is ramped up and widely available, accessible to everybody, and rapid, I think we're going to see a very big change in the numbers.
All right. Dr. Anne Rimoin from UCLA, we thank you very much for spending so much time with us once again today and for everything you know about this and everything you're doing. Thank you.
My pleasure.
And thank you for joining us. We'll continue the conversation on the Frank Buckley Interviews audio podcast. Until next time, have a great week.